Greetings, CSI. I hope those of you in Tokaj are having a wonderful time. For those of us scattered around the globe, we're wishing we were there with you. How many times have you been to Golia? I think I would have been there at least a dozen times by the time you're seeing this. I'd like to talk with you today about inspiration, about the source of inspiration, and how do you keep inspiration going when things are difficult, especially during this coronavirus time. I don't know about you, but I haven't conducted anything since March. But somehow, we all keep going. It's difficult to stay inspired, no? You know, many of you have played in orchestra with me and participated in an exercise. This begins by me asking, why do we do what we do? The purpose of this is to get to the source of joy. To share, first of all, what are those experiences? What music, what ensembles, what is it that caused you to experience joy to the extent that you wanted to devote your life to this music and the making of music together? And acknowledging that it's joy that brings us there and keeps us there, the question then becomes, what is joy? It's not just a tickly feeling in our stomachs, right? It's something with more substance than that, right? And that the source of the joy is actually spiritual. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the presence of God within ourselves and among us. But how does this translate into our daily life? Well, I'd like to take a look at a particular word. In English, it's integrity. And along with that word comes integration. In Hungarian, the word integrity is sértetlenség. My apologies. I know. I tried. Sértetlenség. But integration is integráció. So not the same root. But in English, it's the same root. Integrity and integration. Integrity is that all the facets of my life are integrated so that they function in harmony. So we don't deny one part of ourselves in order to fulfill another part. Let's take a look for a moment at an example of integrity. And that would be Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, it tells us that Jesus went up on a mountain with his disciples. And we know that Jesus' audience was Jewish and very familiar with the laws, such as the Ten Commandments. But he begins by shattering their expectations of what it means to be blessed by God. I want to give you two examples of each of what's called the Beatitudes that begins this Sermon on the Mount. One is a direct translation of Scripture, and the other is a paraphrase. And in English, it's called The Message. It was put together by Eugene Peterson. So Jesus begins by saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." The Message paraphrases this as, "You're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. When there's less of you, there's more of God." The second beatitude is, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." The Message paraphrases, "You're blessed when you feel that you've lost what is most dear to you. Only then can you be embraced by the one most dear to you." "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." "You're blessed when you're content with just who you are, no more, no less. That's the moment you find yourselves proud owners of everything that can't be bought. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." Or, "You're blessed when you've worked up a good appetite for God. He's food and drink and the best meal you'll ever eat." "Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy." Or, "You're blessed when you care. At the moment of being careful, you will find yourselves cared for. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Or, you're blessed when you get inside your world. You're blessed when you get your inside world, your mind and your heart, put right. Then you can see God in the outside world. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Or, you're blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Or, you're blessed when your commitment to God provokes persecution. The persecution drives you even deeper into God's kingdom. Now notice that these are not commandments. For people who've tried to find their own righteousness by following rules, Jesus simply tells them how they're blessed and how they know that when they are blessed. He doesn't say, be meek so that you can inherit the earth. He doesn't say, be merciful so that God will show you mercy. In fact, he goes on to give examples from the Ten Commandments with which his audience was very familiar. For instance, he says, you've heard it said, don't murder. But I tell you that if you hate your brother, you've already murdered him in your heart. You've heard that it said, don't commit adultery. But I tell you, if you look at a woman to lustfully use her, you've already committed adultery in your heart. Jesus shows us that our actions are tied to what is in our hearts, that our actions stem from right or wrong attitudes within us. And when we dig deep into our motivations and become honest with ourselves like this, it can seem, frankly, rather hopeless. But the rest of the story, the rest of the gospel, is that Jesus provides us with his own righteousness, and he demonstrates for us how we can love God and one another. This is an integration of law and spirit, of action and faith. A few years ago, I spent a long weekend in Cluj, Romania, in Coloșvar, with sculptor Liviu Mocan and the playwright Vishki Andraș. And the reason we were spending the weekend together was to come up with a new project, a new song unto the Lord. It was the idea that we could integrate sculptures of Liviu, works of art, with a script written by Andraș and a music composed, all of which would fit together around a singular topic. We came up with many topics, but my favorite one was this idea that we would take the Ten Commandments and these Beatitudes, and interlace them. We take the first commandment and the first Beatitude, and the second commandment and the second Beatitude, and make it like a ladder put together, and show the integration of law and spirit. I will get this done sometime. We have to get this done sometime. I think it will be a very beautiful thing. In the end, integrity comes down to focus, to the one thing that is needed. Years ago, I read a book by the philosopher Soren Kierkegaard. It was called Purity of Heart is to Will One Thing. The one thing was the good, in other words, God. God needs to be our North Star, our life's purpose and our focus. So that our lives are not spread out, they're not diffuse, they're not contradictory or complicated, but rather they're integrated. This North Star, this is the source of our inspiration. It's a well to which we can return day by day, hour by hour, for strength, for sustenance, and for joy. In the second letter to the Corinthians, Paul tells us to take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. Or in the words of the Message, fitting every loose thought, every impulse, every emotion into the structure of life shaped by Christ. Now, this is not so much a commandment. It's not rigid, not something that you force yourself to do, but rather it's the process of bringing all that we think, all that we say, all that we do before the Lord in an interactive relationship. And this is integrity. Not that you get everything right, but that your life has focus, that you find your meaning and your purpose at the source for everything you do. How do you make music with integrity? Well, we view our gifts and the gifts of others as coming from God. We give thanks and praise for them to God. And we work with all our might to do the best we can. In the book of James, he writes, "Every desirable and beneficial gift comes out of heaven. The gifts are rivers of light, cascading down from the Father of light. There is nothing deceitful in God, nothing two-faced." In other words, God is integrity. May God bless you in your music making and in your relationships with God and with each other.
like sand.